Welcome to this episode of Governance Dialogues, a program that I'm hosting on a weekly basis to focus on various economic and corporate governance challenges in conversation with the world's thought leaders. My name is Elisa Cole, and I'm the Managing Director of Govern Center, which is a think tank and advisory firm advising corporate and public policy leaders on various governance challenges. In the past few episodes of Governance Dialogues, we've considered governance primarily from the angle of this crisis which is unfolding. And we've discussed governance from a perspective of international architecture, whether the current global governance architecture is sufficient to help us weather this crisis. We've looked at the question of boards and whether boards are today equipped to help us weather the pandemic, and other angles related to integrity, corruption, and other pertinent angles of governance. And that made sense since the program was actually launched or born during the great lockdown. And since its launch over a month ago, we've had an opportunity to have a number of conversations, which I think were quite fascinating, with a number of thought leaders from all over the world. And so far, most of our dialogues have taken on a global tone and a global approach or perspective. And today I would like to slightly depart from that perspective and travel to a particular country. And we'll be doing that more and more in future episodes of governance dialogues in order to explore country-specific challenges and priorities. And today I will be taking you in this episode of Governance Dialogues to the Middle East and Palestine in particular. And for those of you who had a chance to tune in to previous episodes of the program, you might already have heard from other speakers such as Michal Kanu from Bahrain, Abdulaziz Al-Laisi from Saudi Arabia, and many others. And in today's episode, it's my pleasure to host the head of the Palestine Stock Exchange, Ahmed Awaida, who's joining us directly from Ramallah, if I'm not mistaken, today. So Ahmed, welcome to Governance Dialogues.
Good morning. Hi, Elisa.
Good morning. And thank you for taking the time to join us to tell what I think is quite a fascinating story of a very small market that has, I would say, thrived against all odds, sort of a storm type of situation. And I think you're in a unique position to tell that story, which frankly most people are not aware of. You know, when I say to others, you know, that I work with Palestinians and Palestine Stock Exchange in particular, the global audience, those who are not particularly familiar with the region, and those who don't know Palestine, often kind of look at me with a blank look. And I think it's important to tell your story to an audience that might not be familiar with this particular market. And with that, I would like to sort of say two words to introduce you and maybe two words to introduce the exchange before we jump into the specific question. So you obviously have been leading the efforts to develop the exchange for more than a decade now. You have about 25 years of experience in the sector, but also in banking, telecoms, and you are participating indeed also in global capital markets debates with the World Federation of Exchanges and other industry associations. So I think your insight for our audience would be quite interesting. But let me just step back and say a few words about the development of the exchange and ask you a few poignant questions about how you got this market, in fact, started. So as far as I remember, the exchange takes its roots from basically mid-1990s, where Padico, one of the largest, if not the largest, Palestinian holding company, had actually played a key role in launching the exchange. And I think it was in 97 or so that you had about 10 listed companies come to the market, and sort of this is where this exchange was born. So my first question to you, Ahmed, is really around the roots of the market. Sort of how were you able to start an exchange in such an environment where, you know, you don't have many state-owned enterprises to list, family companies are very difficult to list, and the general economic context is characterized by so many known unknowns and unknown knowns. How did that story come about?
Well, it's certainly quite a unique story. Back with the signing of the Oslo Agreement in 94, there was a lot of repatriation of diaspora capital, and you know, we really needed to kickstart the development process of the Palestinian economy. And Padico, as you said, which is basically the largest Palestinian investment holding, They were aware certainly that, you know, creating the capital market ecosystem would certainly be fundamental to any development process. At the time, you know, very few people thought that the prospects of an exchange, you know, surviving in a country like Palestine were very bleak. We had no regulator, there was no, no rules, no laws, nothing. We started really from zero. And we were quite fortunate actually at the time that the Swedish the International Development Organization and the Stockholm Stock Exchange played a key role in assisting the setup of the exchange and helped us in writing down the rules and the regulations for the exchange. And we're quite unique in the fact that the Palestine Exchange is the only privately owned exchange and publicly traded exchange in the entire Middle Eastern region. I know now that the DFM is still 80% owned by the government of Dubai. So we're a fairly unique organization in terms of the ownership and the structure. And we were self-regulating from 1997 until 2005. By 2005, the Palestinian Authority took the initiative of creating the capital market regulator, and we developed the clear separation of duties and responsibilities between the regulator and the exchange. And if I look at it now, there were very challenges. There were very, very few prospects for the exchange to survive. And like you said, we started with 10 companies back in 1997. Today we're at 48, and our 49th company should be joining us over the next couple of months. We started with a market cap of very low, under $50 million. And today the market cap is just a little bit shy of $4 billion. We have about 105,000 retail and institutional investors. More than 35 foreign institutional investors are already active in the market. And in fact, the exchange itself as a business, it was quite challenging financially also in some of the years, particularly after the great financial crisis of 2008 and 2009. But luckily for us, the exchange itself as a business has been able also to be profitable and is itself listed also on its own exchange. So that's very important.
So Ahmed, you raise an interesting point about the legal status of the exchange, and that has indeed been a whole point of conversation in the marketplaces globally as they started demutualizing and privatizing, and the Palestine Stock Exchange listed its shares, I think it was in 2012. And as you mentioned, your unique story also from that point of view in a region where exchanges are by and large state-owned across the region. And there have been some conversations and thinking about how to corporatize them, privatize them. But that has been a relatively slow process as regulators are concerned around liberalizing the sector. But I wonder if you could say a few words that around potential conflicts of interest that you're managing, because it is a small economy. And as a small exchange in a relatively small economy, with now you have a securities regulator, how do you manage these various conflicts of interest related to your own self-listing?
Well, look, there were certainly many questions about the fact that how can you have the exchange be owned by the investment holding, which is in itself a listed company. So, you know, in fact, the majority shareholder of the exchange is actually one of the listed entities in the exchange. It's really very simple. It's all about drawing up Chinese walls, basically putting in the rules and the regulations and the bylaws of the exchange, that we have certain criteria for board membership. And more importantly as well, the exchange is a regulated entity. We do have a regulator, the Capital Market Authority, that is a full member of IOSCO, that applies IOSCO best practice and principles. And there is a high degree of transparency, I believe, not just only at the exchange, but also at the level of the listed companies themselves. You know, disclosure quality is certainly of a high standard. We're one of the very few markets in the Arab world that provide, for example, full financial disclosures, both in the Arabic and the English. We encourage listed companies to adopt best practices in terms of their investor relations teams. Definitely in the top 10 listings, they all have dedicated IR functions in the organization. So there's a lot of value that is placed on communication, transparency, and communication with the ecosystem in general and with the investor base as well. Because at the end of the day, as a private exchange, as a privately owned exchange, You know, we're not a government institution. We're not a symbol of sovereignty like most other exchanges in the Arab region, in the Middle Eastern region. We are a business, and our credibility, our integrity, our governance is basically an integral part of the business. If people stop believing in the integrity of the exchange, people will stop investing in the exchange, people will stop trading on the exchange, and this will have a direct financial impact on us as a business. So it's not about, you know, we don't have a choice. You know, we are not the kind of institution that basically has to lie back and think, well, you know, we can count on the fact that we are a government entity. So of course, we're a government entity. It means, no, we have to establish the credibility and the trust as a business, because it's basically integral to our revenue stream. So the market is a very, very, I would say, good instrument of discipline. Because this is really what we trade with. We trade with our integrity, our reputation, and the perception of our governance is certainly quite important.
So it's interesting you underscore that. I mean, I think it's a conversation that's relevant or echoes in both the regional context, but also global context. As you know, a number of markets, well, notably NASDAQ, has recently announced that they're looking at tightening of their listing requirements, in part in relationship or as an echo of the Luckin Coffee case, but also perhaps for other reasons. And exchanges have, in different jurisdictions, wielded the corporate governance, let's say, weapon in different ways, as you say, and you don't necessarily have a choice. And I want to sort of come to this question of governance in Palestine, because it's something that was born in Palestine a little bit on the late side, if you compare it to international standards, because your laws, you know, the corporate law was in the West Bank was in 1960s law. So it's difficult to integrate realistically with the political and legal parameters that you have on the ground, some of the good governance concepts in such a politically and legally complicated environment. And I want to sort of probe a little bit more how you're using governance pragmatically as a point of differentiation, perhaps from other markets, because as you said, you don't have a choice as an institution itself, but how do you promote practices within your listed companies? How do you educate or sort of empower them to actually apply them?
Actually, the Capital Market Authority published the governance code for Palestinian listed companies, and the central bank here also has a separate governance code that applies also to the banks specifically, and they are very, very specific in what the requirements are. Like you rightly mentioned, because of the certain deficiencies in the old companies law, for example, we have no allowances in our existing corporate law that cater to minority shareholder representation or independent directors on boards. Nevertheless, we see that many of the leading listed companies on the exchange have opted to incorporate and to appoint representatives of small shareholders and independent directors, i.e. directors on the board who have absolutely no ownership relationship with the company itself. And it is becoming a general practice. And I think also this comes from a realization that even though certain things might not be legally required under the current laws, they are best practice. This is how the process is evolving internationally. And we need, and particularly companies, the larger ones who have an interest in attracting and maintaining institutional foreign investors, they have a direct interest in enhancing their practices, and because they believe that this is fundamental in aiding the marketing of the share to potential investors and eventually better valuation. For example, there's growing awareness now. We have, for example, the Bank of Palestine, Paltel Group, two of the biggest listings on the exchange. They're even now going further into ESG and publishing annual corporate sustainability reporting. And that is not something that is required by the law, but this is coming from the companies themselves, because they see value in adjusting their governance practices and their disclosure practices and their reporting practices with best international practice, simply because they want to be there and they want to be able to work with local and international investors on a higher level. And at the end of the day, I mean, better governance means, you know, it's inevitable. It means better performance, better financial performance, better perception in terms of how the company is perceived in the market, and eventually better valuation. So really, it does affect the pocket. of principal shareholders, and I see the glasses half full or half empty, depends how you look at it, but I see there's definitely growing awareness that if I need to differentiate from myself, not only at the level of the exchange itself, but also at the level of the immediate surroundings, we need to do more. I might just also add that Palestine is quite unique as well in the Arab region, is the participation of the state and the state-owned actors in the exchange and the listed companies is very low in comparison to other markets. And this has historical issues. Of course, the Palestinian Authority is, you know, relatively recent. The Palestinian private sector in general has been quite strong and fairly independent from a very long time. So there's really very little intermarriage between the private sector and the government in Palestine. And I believe this is a healthy thing. And I believe that it enhances the attractiveness of the companies themselves. You will not find many political appointees on boards of Palestinian listed companies. It's just simply not there.
It's interesting. So on perspective on boards, I mean, it's certainly music to my ears, the fact that companies are looking to appoint representatives of minority shareholders, because it is, let's face it, not a common practice in the region. I mean, it sort of draws its some of the best practice examples related to the minority representation on boards come from the UK. So it is quite interesting to hear that this is something that the companies on a small exchange as yours are actually implementing. So congratulations on that. But I would like to perhaps take an opportunity to ask you some questions about regional practices, because you're certainly part of the dialogues and discussions of industry bodies in the region, the Arab Federation of Exchanges. You're very much familiar with practices in other exchanges. And we've recently seen, and Govern and myself have been commenting quite widely on a number of recent cases, such as the NMC case, the Emirati company listed in London, Abraj, Al Mojal. There are a number of cases, more recently, I would say, in the last year or two, that are big, I would say, corporate governance fiascos. So I wonder if you have any thoughts as to what are some of the common themes and what are some of the lessons learned from some of the lessons that we've seen, the fallouts we've seen from these cases in particular across the region?
I believe, you know, there's definitely an issue of enforcement. You know, many times regulators in our region tend to be fairly indulgent, maybe, towards some of the listed companies when it comes to enforcement. You know, I believe there's scope for improvement there. As I said, in some markets, I'm not really referring here to any specific, but in some markets, there might be certain sensitivities, particularly if you take cases where, for example, the government or government-owned entities are principal shareholders in some of these entities. There are certainly certain sensitivities and conflicts of interest in terms of the power and the application of the power. A particular trend that I see, and it's very encouraging across the region, is independent auditors and the kind of effort that is actually now being made by independent auditors when producing the annual reports for companies. I mean, there's definitely more awareness, particularly among the big four firms. You know, there's much, much more awareness about the obligations and the liabilities that are entailed by auditors once they certify and approve annual financial statements for companies. So I am seeing, even at the exchange itself, you know, we are a listed company and we disclose quarterly and, you know, we produce annual, you know, audited annual and semi-annual for, and I see that the kind of issues and the kind of scrutiny now that is being applied by auditors in certifying accounts, that has definitely changed. And particularly, I would say, in the last 3 years, it's very clear that the requirements are much higher now and that the awareness by the auditors themselves of their own liability and responsibility is something that is much more evident than it was before. You know, in certain cases, maybe there might have been, you know, cases where, you know, auditors, and, you know, it's just a formality. Now it's a lot more detailed, it's a lot more thorough, and, you know, they're much more careful and more demanding than they have ever been. And that's a step in the right direction.
Yes, certainly. And I think that the discussion about the audit profession will be going on for quite some time, because as we see, there are a number of issues with EY being investigated. And that was, I think, even on the front pages of the Financial Times today. So it's not a story unique, perhaps, to the region, but also a global story. But with that, I would like to perhaps take a step back and talk about your views on the industry in this particular in a very particular time period. Over the last few months, we've seen a number of exchanges pausing trading activity in the industry body, the WFE, fighting for sort of exchanges to keep the exchanges open over this period. And a lot of instability has occurred in the markets, and a lot of questions are being asked around why the markets, especially the Western markets, are actually not reflecting the underlying economic performance of the unemployment numbers, for example, in the US. So I would, with that, I would like to ask you, what are your thoughts on the outlook for the industry as a whole going forward?
Well, given the present crisis, I believe that exchanges once again, have proved how resilient they are and how capable they are in dealing with the utmost, with one of the biggest crises of our modern history. And the fact is, there was definitely a lot of volatility at one point in time, but most exchanges remained open, and most exchanges were able to provide the crucial services that they do to investors and savers throughout this crisis. Why are a lot of people saying, how come the exchanges are no longer reflecting the real economy? Well, there are two things here. Now, given the amount of support and quantitative easing that has been pumped into the financial system, particularly in the United States and more in Europe, I mean, listen, there's a lot of cash lying around at the moment. There's a lot of cash. And there's a lot of debate as well about, is this going to be a V-shaped recovery or is it going to be a W-shaped recovery? But also one more thing that people, I think, fail to highlight is that not all sectors have suffered from the present crisis. There were many, many losers, but there were clear winners. And there were many of them as well, So the opportunities are always there. Yes, the employment numbers are down. The outlook is grim for the global economy in 2020. That is true. But even at the level of Palestine, not all companies suffered to the same extent. Not all companies suffered in the same way. And as I said, many companies thrived through the crisis because it actually created opportunities. And, one of them is Zoom, the company that we're presently using at the moment for this. Their share price went up by more than 200% during the crisis. So it's not just, the picture is not so black and white. There's a lot of gray in between. And at the end of the day, I mean, look at Amazon. And, and at the end of the day, and even at Palestine, I look at the end of the day, coronavirus or no coronavirus, there's still many companies that are fundamentally sound, well-run, solid business case, sustainable, and that will continue to survive and probably even thrive after this crisis. So it really depends on what kind of a time frame you and as an investor, what kind of outlook and what kind of a sentiment you have on financial markets. The second part of your question in terms of where the industry is going, the industry at the moment is going through a fundamental challenge to its existence. And I think I would refer very briefly to the whole issue of digitization of assets, blockchain technology, and the fact, and what kind of an impact would that have on the exchange industry in general. Now, the reassuring thing is that at the end of the day, blockchain or no blockchain, you will always need a matchmaker. You will always need a matching engine. There will always need to be a place where, orders to buy and orders to sell need to be matched. So the fundamental role, price discovery will always be there. Our fundamental function will not change, even when assets are digitized. So yes, there will definitely be direct impact on the other parts of the value chain, definitely on post-trade, CSD, but then also at the same time, there'll be great improvements in terms of risk management. There'll be great improvements in terms of clearing, settlement, liquidity, velocity of the actual investment cycle. So there are also lots of opportunities and many advantages. And a lot of exchanges, a lot of exchange groups are beginning to seize the kind of moment. And I believe the conversation has shifted now where this was seen as a fundamental threat to the exchange industry. In fact, no, it's probably an opportunity for exchanges to reinvent themselves and sort of retailer the kind of services that they provide within that ecosystem. So we are now at the point of moving from exchange version 1.0 to exchange version 2.0. It will take some time, 5 to 10 years probably tops, but it's definitely happening.
So a number of things that are, I think, are fascinating. One is about sort of the prospects of companies and indeed, you know, the prospects of markets, because some of them have performed quite well on the back of tech stocks. And then you highlighted some of the opportunities that we're seeing also emerge of this crisis. And also the tech of the back office of the tech of the exchanges themselves. I wonder, sort of, as we wrap up today's conversation, if you could say in maybe a few sentences very briefly, with this transition from, as you say, 1.0 to 2.0, the enormous instability in the markets that likely we will continue to see unfold over the next few months, what are some of the issues that you think all over the world, not only in Palestine, are keeping stock exchange CEOs awake at night?
Well, definitely the biggest challenge today now, because, you know, we're not gonna, you know, our business model is challenged. You know, our business model is challenged from many areas. You know, our core trading business is challenged because of there's definitely competition from other options of capital raising, you know, private equity, family offices, etc. So, you know, companies, entrepreneurs and businesses now have much more options when it comes to capital raising. So this is definitely about how can we reinvent ourselves, in order to be able to compete more efficiently against these new financing models, you know, crowdfunding, for example, you know, and B, how can we enlarge our outreach in order to cater for different types of companies, of issuers, you know, or even different kinds of instruments. You know, digitization of assets, you know, creates a tremendous opportunity for exchanges, because now we're basically trading what? Currencies, equities, bonds, you know, derivative contracts. Imagine a situation, for example, where car ownership is completely dematerialized, or land and property ownership is completely dematerialized through blockchain, and whereby you can basically buy and sell your car, or, you know, buy and sell your house or apartment through an exchange. And for that to be electronically done, because at the end of the day, all you will do, you'll have a digital coin that represents the apartment you're sitting in. And for you, the whole, just imagine how much quicker, how much cheaper, how much more secure this will become. And exchanges, I believe, because we are at the end of the day, as I said, you will always need a matching engine. You will always need a place where people can come to offer to buy and offer to send. I believe as exchanges, we have a great role to play in this new economy. Now, does the development of this new version, exchange version 2.0, depend on us exclusively? Clearly not. It needs to be part of an ecosystem. The regulator needs to be on board. The central bank needs to be on board, because at the end of the day, a digital asset needs a digital currency for it to be exchanged with. So we're a long way away, but it's not going to take 20 years. It's not. I believe it's happening within the next 5 to 10 years. It will be there. And in the meantime, as I said, you know, it's really about trying to find alternative sources of income. As I said, we are for profit. We're private companies. We're listed companies. And we need to create value for our shareholders. It's interesting, for example, like I see the issue of the acquisition of LSE, Refinitiv by, you know, LSE. That's just fascinating, because if you look at the revenue pie of the London Exchange Group beyond the merger, basically the London Stock Exchange Group is going to fundamentally become a data company. This is where most of the revenues are going to be coming from in the future, not the core traditional trading role. And, you know, NASDAQ, for example, they're big on as a technology provider, you know. So each big group is trying to define a niche where it has a comparative advantage and stick to it. Us as smaller exchanges, well, we need to find our little place. And digitization is also a big threat to small standalone national exchanges. I am personally of the opinion that there's no place for standalone national exchanges for much longer. Mm. You know, whatever, what political will, and I refer now to the Middle East specifically, what political will has hindered for so long. You know, we have situations in the Arab world, you know, if you think about it, all the Arab exchanges, all 17 Arab exchanges are, you know, they're fairly small, relatively speaking. You know, any effort at integration has not borne fruit, while there are many, many advantages. We even have situations in certain countries where there are more than one exchange within the same jurisdiction, not justified. And I believe the technological evolution will force some kind of regionalization of the liquidity pools, because this is the only way forward. You need to stay relevant, and you can't remain relevant being small and closed.
So I think a number of trends that I think are would be fascinating to explore even in future dialogues, if you will indulge us for future episodes on transition, transition that is faced by large exchange groups to, as you described, essentially data vendors and the positioning of exchanges, which I think also is very interesting. You mentioned in terms of as a matchmaker, perhaps in other ways that we've so far not seen. And I know this is something that you're thinking of going forward. So hopefully we'll have a chance to host you on future episodes of Governance Dialogues to discuss further this tech transition, which I think is quite fascinating. But for the purposes of today, we would like to very much thank you for joining us for this fascinating conversation on the changes that you are overseeing in Palestine, but also changes in the wider stock exchange industry.
Thank you so much for giving me the opportunity, and I very much enjoyed it.
Thank you, Ahmed. And for our global audience, I'd like to just mention that this episode will be available on our YouTube channel. You can feel free to subscribe and share the episodes that we are recording and sharing on a weekly basis. Thank you for tuning in.